I'm the Night King. I'm big and scary. Yeah, I'm dead now.
When Game of Thrones first introduced the character the Night King, there was a lot of speculation as to who exactly he actually was.
In the novels by George R. R. Martin, there is of course the Night's King, with an apostrophe, a legendary figure who was said to have given his soul to a woman whose skin was as pale and as cold as snow and whose eyes burned like bright blue stars. Together they ruled over the Night Fort until they were taken down when the King of Winter, a Stark of Winterfell, and the King beyond the Wall took up arms together against them. But pretty soon after the Night King figure was introduced in the show, George R. R. Martin posted that the legendary figure from his books was not likely to make an appearance in modern A Song of Ice and Fire. So that led many of us to believe that the Night King was in fact a show-only creation. I actually never minded the creation of the Night King. In the books, it seemed as though the others are driven by a metaphysical force. There is no specific leader, no king in the sense that men have kings. It is easier and even useful in a visual medium like television to present the ruler of the others as a physical character rather than trying to explain the arcane nature of the others' existence as it is in the books. I really do think that the show set up some pretty interesting things with the Night King. Unfortunately, most of it was never followed through on. The spirals, for instance. I told you guys from the beginning that those spirals meant nothing, those symbols meant nothing, because they're not in the books. And if it's not George R. R. Martin coming up with these weird esoteric ideas, then it's not gonna mean anything. It's just gonna be hollow and empty, and they're just for style, and that's exactly what they turned out to be in the end. The figure that we call the Night King was first shown on screen in season 4. The name Night King was actually never said in the show until season 6, which really annoyed me because the show suddenly started acting like the name had been a part of the show all along and as though the Night King as the ruler of the White Walkers was already an established part of their legends. But I could have even forgiven this if they had given us more about who he actually was and what he really wanted. George R. R. Martin has made it clear that his others are not merely mindless bringers of death. So why portray the White Walkers in the show as such? Especially when you actually have a physical character meant to represent the Great Other. I had my fingers crossed in season 8 for the Night King to speak, but he didn't. The Night King has no personality, no motivation. I don't hate him. I don't like him. He is about as empty of a character as you could get. In fact, even referring to him as a character doesn't seem right. The dragons had more personality than he did. He was a prop, a forgettable, hollow adversary not worthy of the name Night King. I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that the Night King is one of the worst fantasy villains of all time. In the Lord of the Rings movies, Sauron does not speak, but his presence is always felt and known. The Night King will certainly not be remembered in the same way as Sauron. Well-known choreographer and stuntman Vladimir Furtick played the Night King from season 6 to season 8. In the Game of Thrones documentary, which aired the week after the final episode, Vladimir briefly stated that during the filming of The Long Night, he first began to realize that he was portraying an extra rather than a real character. It's pretty sad that even Vladimir, who seemed pretty excited to play the Night King, seems disappointed in where the character's arc ultimately led. Game of Thrones was always heralded as having such realistic and believable villains. I guess I started to see the cracks when they turned Ramsay Bolton into merely a more over-the-top version of Joffrey. But the Night King is an entirely different level of terrible, and in an entirely different way. Since David and Dan's most recent interview leaked onto the internet, we have been given insight on why so many things on the show went so wrong. Many of the problems stemmed from the pair's seeming disdain for the fantasy genre. The idea of a fantasy villain like the Night King must have seemed silly to them, and perhaps ultimately this is why they put no effort into actually making him a good villain. When I saw the Night King be taken out so ridiculously easy, I held on to a modicum of hope that there was something more. He transferred his soul into Bran. This could have all been some convoluted, elaborate misdirection. But I knew deep down that it wasn't true. When little Arya plunged a dagger into the Night King and his entire army shattered into ice shards, leaving no trace, I knew it was the end. You know, even Mr. Freeze from Joel Schumacher's 1997 critically panned Batman and Robin is a better villain than the Night King. Mr. Freeze actually had a backstory and a real motivation. It's just after all that we went through with this show, 7 seasons of building up the legendary White Walkers, which caused a darkness that lasted a generation, as an unstoppable force of destruction and death, just to have it all end in one night. I guess I'll leave you guys with this quote from George R. R. Martin on villains, because it tells us pretty much everything that's wrong with the Night King in the show. We don't need any more Dark Lords. We don't need any more. Here are the good guys, they're in white. There are the bad guys, they're in black. And also they're really ugly, the bad guys. It is certainly a genuine, legitimate topic as the core of fantasy, but I think the battle between good and evil is waged within individual human hearts. We all have good in us and we all have evil in us, and we may do a wonderful good act on Tuesday and a horrible, selfish, bad act on Wednesday, and to me, that's the great human drama of fiction. I believe in gray characters, as I've said before. We all have good and evil in us, and there are very few pure paragons, and there are very few orcs. A villain is a hero of the other side, as someone once said, and I think there is a great deal of truth to that. And that's the interesting thing in the case of war, that kind of situation. So I think some of that is definitely what I'm aiming for. The mistakes that Game of Thrones made with its main villain made me think a lot about how I would portray villains in my upcoming graphic novel series, Tadia. Link in the description for more information.